Hey, and welcome to Content. For this episode, I got some old friends to get on the phone and join me on a trip down memory lane. So I caught up with James McKean and Danny Nash of Scottish emotional hardcore legends, Departures. Departures left their indelible mark on the UK hardcore scene with their albums When Losing Everything Is Everything You Wanted, Teenage Haze, and Death Touches Us From the Moment We Begin to Live. The last two recorded by myself at the ranch. After a brief farewell tour, Departures disbanded in 2019. It was really good fun to reflect on the making of those records and have a good chat with James and Danny. It's been a long time, and I thought I'd make some great content, so here you go.
I tell you what, let's invert the paradigm and I'll just ask you a bunch of questions then. So I'm going to start with just about the session. What memories have you got from, I guess, either Teenage Haze or Death Touches Us? Anything jump out of the old memory banks in the mind palace that you sometimes replay? I can tell you one for me. Yeah. It'll be probably my never-ending memory of that session is the fact I remember you getting out of the van at like 11 a.m. having driven down that night and Ali getting straight behind the drums. That is something I remember. Just straight in. Got the gloves on. Got his Metallica gloves on.
Oh, of course. Yeah,
just straight behind the kit.
That doesn't feel that unusual to us just because we're from Glasgow. There's been a lot of times where we've driven for fucking hours and hours and hours and then immediately played in some capacity. Teenage Haze always sticks out in my memory because I had cancer at the time we were recording. Just sorry to bring the fucking tone down immediately.
Oh, you've brought it down.
I'm sorry, lads. But no, that is, do you know what? It always makes me think of that because I was in like shitloads of pain while we were recording that album and had no idea why. Mm. And it was actually the amount of pain that I was in while we recorded that album actually led to me going to the doctors about it. So that sticks out in my mind.
Yeah.
Not that that's got anything to do with the actual recording of the album.
No, but I mean, I do remember that. I remember you saying you're in discomfort while you're in the studio and then when you left to go back up and we kept in touch about the record and stuff, you basically weren't very well immediately after doing it.
Yeah, it certainly wasn't. Yeah,
linger in the memory.
But that album and that sort of experiences like always they're now fucking they're completely inseparable in my mind for all that reason, and they always have been ever since that happened. I remember Trainer eating 40 chicken nuggets from McDonald's in one go.
That's right. That was the second time I remember
Death Touches Us. So I remember that vividly.
Chicken nuggets touch us.
Yeah, he actually looked like he was going to pass out.
40 chicken nuggets?
He wasn't there for that.
That was at night. He ate it and I've got a video of that and I was like, how do you feel? And he goes, I feel ashamed of myself. And I remember that quite well.
There's not an awful lot of Trainer to handle 40 chicken nuggets. You know what I mean?
I think there was just a lot of regret by the time you hit about 30 chicken nuggets.
But it was the sunk cost fallacy. You had to keep going.
That slides into the pantheon of atrocious food decisions he made at the ranch. I can recite one or two from memory, and two of them the same guy. He bought a box of donuts for everyone, so it must have been like 12 or 16 donuts. And he offered them around and no one wanted them. So he ate them all.
Wow.
So that was one week. And in my mind, it was like the next week. But he turned up and it was a baking hot day. It was in July. It was like 30 degrees or whatever. And about 4 p.m., he was like, oh, fuck. I left a chicken sandwich in my car. And he went and got it. And it was like...
No.
It was humming with heat.
That's bad.
Yeah, he ate it. And then he was like, oh, I don't feel very well. He disappeared for about an hour. He came back from Sainsbury's having Googled what to do if you've got salmonella. And someone on the internet had said, eat a load of garlic. So he'd eaten a bulb of garlic. An entire bulb of garlic to kind of cancel out the salmonella.
Wow.
Weren't you doing your dissertation when you were in once? I remember you writing some essay.
I think the last time I think I'd started working on my thesis, which I'm finishing.
Has it not finished yet?
No. Oh man, well, just a cavalcade of of nonsense. It's fine. I had a heart attack. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Was it Teenage Haze where you had the, like, the real frozen voice thing?
Cause yeah.
Because I remember the second one was much smoother.
And I think I felt I was more relaxed about the whole thing. Because I brought all of the words with me. And, crucially, we practiced the songs.
There you go. The last there thing, you go.
I'd listened to the songs, but I hadn't actually tried to, like, put any lyrics over them. I'd done it in my head, which is fine. But it's not the same as actually standing and trying to do it, especially when I can't actually do it, like, scream like an idiot in a recording booth.
That's probably a point worth raising. We did talk briefly before we hit record about this. Basically had, like, vocal paralysis. And that was the first time I'd ever experienced that. But like I said earlier, it's not like a one-off thing. It's something that I've actually experienced a few times since. But I think yours definitely is contextual to some degree. hence why the second album we did together. If I remember rightly, we started doing vocals earlier as well.
I think that was Danny's great idea. He was like, we'll start doing them rather than doing them all at the end. I'm like, that's probably an idea so that it's not all on my shoulders.
Take some pressure off.
I've carried that on ever since. And anytime I'm doing an album, I break it up all the time.
Yeah, it was such a good idea. I forgot about that. That's right.
But no, that went all right, wasn't it? It's like, what, 7 or 8 days we did the whole record. We all did all right. What's your Spotify plays like? Have you ever looked at it? How many plays? You've had loads. Hundred thousand odd plus. On nearly every track.
It's all right, yeah. I mean, we made a point of like pointing out that we'd gone over 3 million just because we couldn't actually believe that we'd done that.
3 million?
Well, in total, yeah.
Did you make some money out of Spotify then?
No.
Pocketed it all.
He's got it all.
Got it all. He'd be like, no, I didn't.
So those curtains there are silk. That's pure silk.
I think the money that, because like we don't put the stuff up on Spotify, so obviously I think the money that we get paid for Spotify comes in through the money we get paid through whatever record label is that's giving us money whenever that, you know, the odd occasion that that happens.
Yeah,
we probably have made like a small bit of money off that, but I don't know.
It's a weird one. This is something that over the last few years I'm way out of touch, but just trying to keep up with bands and how they make money. And Spotify, if you can get the plays, if you go on the playlist, you can make some serious bunts doing it, or at least like respectable bunts. The minute you're on a label, it will change, I think.
Yeah,
I think so. And I think Spotify themselves are making money by making fake tracks and then putting them on. And I listen to these when I'm writing and studying. Yeah, like they're sort of like the chill out ambient stuff or relaxing piano, or it'll be like great adventure hiking or some nonsense like that. And they've just got like a song and it's only one song, it's on that and they own it. And then because it's just a playlist where you're not actually listening to what tracks are on it. It's just on in the background. It just goes on and on and on. And they're racking up all these plays. So I don't know how that
I had no idea that that was a thing.
When I did my Spotify songs of the year, or like, you know, when it does that, your playlist of the year, it tells you what you've listened to more than anything else and that kind of shit. My number one play track was Brown Noise. Which tells you quite a lot about me, I think.
That's pretty good. I did try listening to White Noise at one point. That was pretty good.
Why is it too harsh? Brown's where it's at.
The brown sound.
Yeah, so it's high pass, so it's just like quite low.
All right.
It's nice.
So what's the benefit to listening to that?
In my other life, I do some stuff at university. I teach at university. Just a day a week or whatever, 2 days a week sometimes. If I'm doing anything academic, I can't concentrate unless I have Brown Noise on. Then I can kind of focus and do my mark.
Well, I suppose your job involves sort of destroying your ears.
Yeah, pretty much. Good. Although they're holding up, so I won't complain too much. Unlike other parts of me. So we're in COVID lockdown 2020. this is a question which probably has a lot of answers because of where we are right now in lockdown, but how different is your life now to 5 years ago when we're in the studio?
I mean, obviously, everything's fucking different now just because everything's got a bit weird. So, I mean, you could almost say that your life now is quite different than it was like 3 months ago.
It's really different for me. I'm sat in drinking every night, not seeing anyone. Tina, what about you? What's changed for you in 5 years?
Lots of things, mainly because of the old heart attack.
Yeah, so for context, if I remember rightly, you were on tour with someone pretty good, wasn't it?
Tushia Mori,
and you had a bit of a scary incident.
Just a wee bit. Yeah, we're at the Brudenell Social Club. It's the one that the Cribs played at, which is pretty
significant
for me. And yeah, we're halfway through a set. And I just said, I feel like I've just had a small heart attack. And then I looked at Kaz. I remember looking at Kaz. He was like, are you okay? Because he must have looked at me and gone, he looks like he's... I was like, it's fine. It's fine. So I just so I just carried on. Just finished the set, felt whatever. And then we're sitting backstage and people were just saying, oh yeah, I've got a pain here. And everyone was giving me their diagnosis of what had happened. It's like, I'll be fine because once I drank lots of Red Bull and I had a pain just to the left and in the middle. So that's fine. I was like, all right, that's fine. So then doing about it, I think we drove to Manchester. I just thought I had heartburn and then went to Rob's and I just went to bed. I was like, this is rubbish. And then I woke up at 8:30. I remember specifically it was 8:30 and I was like, I should really do something about this. And because I'm a man, don't really do anything about any sort of medical issue. But I was, something was like, you should probably do something. You should need to phone. Like, this isn't... Because I'd gobbed, like, lots of Gaviscon or something. We'd gone into Asda. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, I remember walking around Asda and you looked fucked. And then I went, are you all right? And you went, no, I'm fucking not. Like that.
I remember that as well.
Yeah, and I just went, I'm going to fuck myself then. Fuck you.
I actually do remember saying that.
I will go and shove that right up my ass.
I phoned like NHS 24 and I was like, yeah, I've got this sort of pain in my chest. And they were like, right, I'm going to send an ambulance. And I was like, oh, do you have to? That seems like a burden. I don't want to be a burden on anyone. Don't do that. And they're like, no, everything you've explained is like proper.
Bloody hell.
And then I went to hospital. No one came with me. So I'm like that. The bygones, I'm not better about that. But everyone that asked it, because they would ask me what happened, and I was like, oh, I'm in a band and stuff. Every health professional that spoke to me was like, oh, are you taking cocaine? I felt like I should have wrote on my forehead. Wore a t-shirt saying, I wasn't taking cocaine. It was everyone. I don't know why I couldn't just write it on like a bit of paper or something, and be like, stop asking him. And then got admitted and then spent about 2 weeks in Manchester, or in Salford to be specific.
Oh, that sounds rough.
Pretty mad though, because I was seen by like a different nurse every day.
So following this up, how has your life changed over the last couple of years then?
They now told me that I have a vascular Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, which means that all my insides are fragile and stuff, and I can't do any contact sport or anything that exciting.
What, if it was made an Olympic sport, would you have a good chance of winning gold in?
Oh, Tetris.
Tetris.
Tetris. I am
fucking hell, man.
Brilliant at Tetris.
Really?
Of all the computer games that exist, Tetris is the one. I am formidable. A formidable...
Wow.
I don't think there's a word for a Tetris player.
That's a good shout.
I don't know how or why, but that is it. That's good. Tennis. Nice. Definitely tennis.
Cool. Where you at, Danny?
Okay, I reckon I would be an Olympic gold medalist at annoying people into watching films or listening to music that I want them to listen to.
Is that right? Really? That's impressive.
Just irritating people to the point where they do. Like, Keno right now is playing the game Bloodborne because I've annoyed him about it for years because I'm like, yes. It's fucking great.
Yes.
I quite enjoy like making people like experience stuff that I'm into, even if they don't enjoy it.
I need to take lessons. I mean, I assume I've been called a punisher by at least one or two people in the past. But
I guess that's a description for it, actually. Yeah.
To be an Olympic gold level punisher, that's impressive.
Yeah,
that's good. You should go into social media or something.
But that's the sort of trick of, it's not really a trick, but it's like getting someone to watch something, like maybe around at Danny's, I should watch this film, and then the film would be on, and then that's it, I've got to watch it now because he's put it on. I think that's what happened with Children of Men. That was
what a film that is, though. That is a great film.
It's always good stuff. It's always stuff I know people will like.
So is this the hill you die on? Like, I'm gonna bully you until you watch it, and I'm gonna stand by my opinion. It's my theory.
No.
If I go whole hog and I'm like, this is so good, you have to watch it. Full stop, saying every single one of those words, and they don't like it, then it's like, I'm done. All right, here's the last question. This is what I'm gonna end on.
Right.
Have you ever seen a ghost? Or do you have a ghostly tale to tell?
I once thought that there was a sort of disembodied voice that spoke. Like, I was at my grandma and granddad's, and I was setting up a computer, or I was turning the computer on, and I remember it so vividly, and I can't remember what it said, but it seemed to come from absolutely nowhere.
I remember what it said.
Pretty sure if I did some sort of regressive therapy. It would come to me, but it was quite clear as in, like, this is a voice that there wasn't a television on, not anything, like just a voice from nothing.
Jesus,
that's something that's happened, and I remember it.
Wow, that's pretty interesting. I like that. That's great.
Pretty bizarre.
Yeah, it's really good. Danny,
we once recorded at a studio in Glasgow, an old band I was in years ago. We recorded at a studio called Savar, which I don't think it exists anymore, but it was in an old church. Sava. And the guy that was recording this, obviously the studio was underneath the church and it still had this church light in it. And the guy told me it was haunted. I think he was probably winding me up, to be honest. But there was a room upstairs where you could sort of go in and look into the church, and I got really drunk one night because we were fucking honestly drinking. Like, there was so much drinking going on when we were doing that. And I went up into this wee room on my own and just stared into the church for about like 10 solid minutes. And to the point where in my brain I was shitting myself because I was like properly like kept looking, and like, because I was wanting to see it. If it was there, I was like, I fucking need to see this. Apparently, I can't even remember what it was. They said haunted it, like an old woman or something like that.
It's always like a green lady.
It's
the green lady.
Exactly. It was bollocks. But
she will show you her presence.
He told me some specific stories about other guys that worked there and what they'd seen and all that stuff, and I was like, right, I fucking want to see this. So
Danny Nash staring into the void.
So I was like looking through this window into this church for ages, and but then I was like properly panicking with fear because of how long I've been in this silent room staring at this church.
Yeah, that is.
And then again, I was like, I need to fucking spot this. But then I looked for that long. I was like, well, I might as well keep going at this point because I've been here this long and nothing's happened yet. Nothing ever did happen, though, unfortunately.
Of course it didn't. Keno, I don't believe in ghosts, but I do love a ghost story. But I remember vividly as a kid two auditory hallucinations, one of which was listening to a Nine Inch Nails record, and suddenly I heard someone talking to me and I fucking lost my mind. And another time, I remember all I could hear quietly was little kid laughter.
No, I was like, absolutely not.
Oh, God, fuck no. What is that? Then I could hear this other sound, which is like keening, kind of like noise coming, and it got closer and closer, and I was like, oh fuck, the back door exploded open with my dad came running in his underwear, chased by four or five other men in their underwear. They went straight past me, straight up the stairs. Then there's loads of tussling. Then they came back downstairs. They're carrying my dad out of the house. And I was like, what the fuck?
Were you inside a Monty Python sketch?
So what happened? I figured out they were next door. So I went next door and basically my dad had met the neighbours. It was like a big rugger bugger guy.
Oh,
and all his rugger bugger mates are there. And they'd all got pissed. And my dad had told them that he could do judo. And he tried to judo throw one of these guys. Anyway, so all that laughter, all that noise I could hear was just them all like basically pissed up fighting. So yeah, that's my ghostly experience when I was about 15.
Yeah, absolutely.
And on that bombshell, let's wrap up there again.
On the judo bombshell.
On the judo bombshell. My dad will kill me if I ever get something. Right, that was fun.
All right, man.
Oh, that's fun. Thanks very much.
Really nice to see you, man. Both. Keep safe and keep in touch. Yeah.
Yeah, you too.
You too, man. Cheers.
Enjoy the rest of the old lockdown.
Thanks, mate. Yeah, you too.
Keep safe. Thanks, man. Bye.